did this test once and I almost hit my knee really bad. And this is basically our target. Candlelight somehow. This is the flash. Now, let's turn on this light so I don't kill myself. This is a weak light, generally speaking. It's the raw light bulb. So this is pretty much what we got here. And also a little light in the kitchen. So let's go in the corridor and shoot that thing. So what we got? It's in, huh? It's in. It's a little bit off in the sense of the label, how it looks, because the label is askew. You see, the label is askew on the side. So it's not really focused on the label. It's focused on the tray, mostly. On the tray, not the label. So, and some of them were dark, because the flash didn't fire in the middle. So, but it's not bad. It's not bad. So if I had focused differently, meaning on the label, instead of on the tray, see how sharp the tray is? See, the label is missing it a little bit. Let's try that again. Let's try that again. So this time, let's turn the label a little here so that it's more contrasty in a way. You know what? I don't really need that. Is that thing still filming? So let's try that here. Without that freaking light. I'm guessing the flash needs, you see, beep, 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 beep. It's bitching. It needs something more than just AA batteries. So let's check it out now. Yep, now it's in. See that? That was a remote controlled flash with a WRR10. And what would help more would obviously be an external power source for the flash, because it only had the WA batteries from the gas station, the D850 grip, and a tripod, because I was shaking the camera up and down, holding it with one hand while holding the cell phone with the other hand. It's as if I was trying to sabotage the autofocus system on purpose.
And what I loved about this camera is that the image quality is unmatched. It's 45 megapixels, it's sharp as heck. And also it's just a reliable camera, it does everything. I took portraits with it, landscapes, studio work, wildlife, everything, and it worked well. Now, it does have 7 frames per second, which is much slower than mirrorless cameras. You can put the grip on and get 9 frames per second. And it's quite bulky, but it's got features that I love that I still don't see in other cameras. And that's like the lighted buttons if you're doing astro. And it's also, I think, an amazing deal because you can get one of these used for $2,000. And this takes video too.
Yeah, not well, but.
It does a pretty good job, Tony. We're not here. We don't have to criticize today, Tony. Jeez. But yeah, this is still remains my favorite DSLR ever. I would recommend this to people that aren't ready to move to mirrorless or don't want to, like, what would it be like? The new gear tax? I feel like mirrorless stuff is so expensive.
Yeah, exactly. It's just totally capable. It just doesn't have eye detect.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't have all those fancy features, but you get the job done and the photos look great. And the dynamic range is insane. It's like 15 stops of dynamic range. I don't think anyone has even matched that. Is there a camera
No, nothing's really better.
Yeah.
Did you see the little thing at the end? It said here, the D850 has the same dynamic range as the medium format Hasselblad X1D. And Lloyd Chambers has called it the cleanest full-frame sensor ever. Well, for astrophotography, actually, it's the D810. Anyway, that was my first shutter click ever with the D850. This is a body I still have, by the way. And we kept this image. It was a test image. We kept it because it was weird. And the same day, the camera impressed me. Not because dynamic range and stuff. Dynamic range is something that you do not really see easily in pictures. If it's 12 stops or 15 stops, you're not going to see it easily. But it impressed me over here in this image because this leg did not belong to anybody. It looked kind of weird from afar. So I got close and I raised the shadows and I see that I could raise shadows and everything without a change in color, without color shift. That was the impressive part. 4.5 years ago, that was pretty big. The D810 was not exactly that good. And 2 months later than that, or 3 months later than that, I tested the Sony A7R II. It didn't even come close to this performance. Now one would say, well, you know, there is a little flag in the RAW files of the D850 that puts the color noise reduction up immediately. And if you put it to zero, there is a little bit of noise, color noise in the noise. A little bit, okay? But this has nothing to do with color stability. The color, this color did not shift, and that's the important part. What happens in the noise, inside the noise, that's a totally different deal. And you can actually correct the noise quite easily too. So even with all these flags deactivated, the color of her jacket and everything and the hair did not change. That's my point. Did not shift when I pulled the shadows up to 100. That made the shadow performance impressive. Details that would look almost black in the RAW file, you could just slide this to 100 without having color shift. What I didn't like about the D850, first of all, it's an SLR, so you have to fine-tune some lenses. If you buy high-end Nikon lenses, brand new, my experience is you're not going to have to do that. They're so well adjusted and everything. But if you buy used, even the good ones, like the 85 1.4, that lens I bought it used and it was so out of whack, probably the previous owner had dropped it somewhere, that it was impossible to fine-tune. Mirrorless cameras, on the other hand, theoretically at least, they force the lens, even if it's defective, to focus at least at the focus point where you want it. And this way you may actually have less fringing and chromatic aberrations around the focus area. Number two, it's a lot bigger actually than the D750. And it's got the same stuff with the D750. I'm trying to think if it has anything more in terms of hardware. The D750 has the motor, the Wi-Fi, the Bluetooth, all that crap, the flippy screen. So why is this, the D850, so much bigger? I can't understand this. I mean, heat dissipation, perhaps? Like if somebody wants to record a half an hour 4K video, who the hell is going to do that? Number three, the shutter is not as smooth as the D810. With the D810, 0.4 seconds, half a second, exposure, non-stabilized 28 lens. There is no shaking. I mean, there is noise, all right, that you can fix and everything, but there is no shaking. Half a second exposure. She shook her hand, and that was visible. The rest is just still. Here, quarter of a second, 0.25. You take out the noise, it's halfway decent. And finally, there is a little bit of a shutter lag. It's not as bad. I mean, people think that's normal. And the mirrorless cameras, all the way up to the latest Z9, had an even longer shutter lag than that. However, so here is how the D850 sounds. Looks like a lot of things are going on in there. Here is how the D500 sounds. D850. D500. I know it's not much. It's a tiny fraction of a second, but it gives it a sense of immediacy. That's why my daughter likes the D850 so much. It's like a rangefinder camera in a way. It responds instantly. Okay, small correction. I wanted to say my daughter likes the D500 so much because it responds instantly. And if you switch it to the multiple shots, sounds like a choo-choo train, a D850. D500. Now, yeah, this is kind of splitting hair because you get adjusted to it. Because even from the first day, I could take the Canon shot, just as I could in the old days with my 5-megapixel pocket camera. I'm kind of lucky with that stuff. So let's just say that the D500 would have captured this image, the D850 the beginning of the splash. I almost forgot it. There is an inherent problem with SLRs on autofocusing at the edges with wide-angle lenses. And people started noticing it only after the high-resolution bodies were released. Nikon issued a firmware update that kind of improves it. So at least with a 28mm, you can focus at the edges in live view, choosing live view. But if you're choosing a viewfinder and you try to focus on the very edges, better focus and recompose or focus manually. And if you're using a fisheye, try and focusing at the edges with an SLR, just forget about it, manually all the way. With Nikon autofocus lenses series G, you can actually grab the ring, even if the lens is in autofocus mode, and when you grab the ring, it will immediately override the autofocus and give you manual control. It's not going to screw up the lens. If you have the older series D lenses, don't do that. It will screw up the lens. What I liked, the color neutral shadow recovery, I talked about that, works flawlessly in insanely low temperatures. That night in December 2017, and it was the week when I was also testing the A7R2 and the GFX50. The temperature was minus 16, not accounting for the wind blast. With the wind blast, about minus 28 Fahrenheit. The news were saying do not expose skin for more than 2 minutes. I went to the location, put the camera on the tripod, somebody calls me, I get in the car and I talk about 15 to 20 minutes. I get out, camera, lens, everything frozen. And I took the pictures and it worked flawlessly as if it was in normal conditions, no problem whatsoever. And no timing problem on the shutter either, mechanical shutter. The next day I took the Sony A7R2 in the forest and it was not wind blast. And within 10, 12 minutes it stopped working. So you take winter images, Chicago or Minnesota or what have you, you know.
I'm hoping to show you this spectacular composition in once in a lifetime light. But unfortunately my camera has let me down. And what has happened, I don't know why, but basically anytime I try to focus either manually or with autofocus, the camera completely craps out, seizes up, the EVF goes blank, and the LCD goes blank. I can't see anything, I can't do anything. And I've tried taking the battery out, I've tried reattaching the lens.
Sony is like a cat. It's fast and playful, but it doesn't like the cold. Color science. Probably the most accurate, in my opinion, after Hasselblad. Now, Hasselblad is the ultimate as far as color science is concerned. And pixel plasticity, that's how I called it. I think I was one of the first channels, if not the first, that talked about the pixel plasticity of the D810 and the D850. Others have reported that as well, that the pixels do not really fall apart that easily as with other cameras. Now, the D810 is even more than the D850 in how much you can, let's say, upscale an image without it falling apart. So, for example, and I scaled this exactly. The D810 is this image, the black one. The D850 is this image size. All right. So that's 36, that's 45, the red one. Now, if you are upscaling them, let's say that the D850 will go, let's say it can go a lot bigger, but let's say it can go all the way here. When you upscale the D810, provided that you use the same lens, blah, 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 and everything, the gap kind of narrows. And that's because the pixels are bigger. And finally, it works flawlessly and smartly with all the Nikon speed lights. Smartly, I mean that the Nikon lighting system is supposed to be smart, and it's got some features that are purely intuitive in a way, but it works. And I cannot say the same about the Z7, my experience with it, with speed lights. And I'm sure there is a solution somewhere, but with the D850 or the D810, I don't need to find a solution because there is no problem. So for example, when I made this video about the E3 setting, a very important setting, where I just chose to compensate only for the background, and I set it to all zero, and then minus one, and then minus two, the camera was doing exactly what it's supposed to be doing, although the item was fairly close to the background. It was like magic. How does the camera know? Especially a DSLR. And it did it, first attempt. And your exposure compensation settings, even without the E3 setting, when you're just measuring to take a photo in the shadow, for example, it will follow the focus point area, regardless of where you put the focus point. And there was another question by somebody in the past, now that I remember it. The virtual horizon, can I have it in the viewfinder of the DSLR? Okay, so now I put the camera a little bit askew and look at the viewfinder. Do you see at the bottom of the image itself, some black bars? This is the alignment of the camera. Horizontal, and on that side, on the right side, I don't know if I can, it also has vertical. I don't know if it captures the entire thing, the phone. So those black bars, and I can deactivate this, so it doesn't show at all. So now, for example, I deactivated all the visual information inside the image. But I can do that on the live view screen as well. And now I can press this button, start appearing a lot of things, or I can leave it as that to frame my image accurately. And this has driven nuts the mirrorless shooters of Nikon. I do not know if they have fixed the issue on the Z7, where you had all this information. I mean, all right, take out the artificial horizon, because this appears only by choice. but all the rest was there by default somehow. And I could not deactivate all that stuff. And it was overlaying in the image. It looked, even in the viewfinder, like an F-16 cockpit. This is the minimum that would display, because when you have pressed the button, a lot of other little things would appear as well. And people were complaining about this, because they could not find a way to deactivate this. Neither did I. And I don't know if they have fixed this, and they should. They should have an option where you see only the image, nothing more. Because otherwise, it is a bad shooting experience, and people can ditch the camera just for that. And some people did. They did not find the Z7 and the Z6 excellent implementations. Actually, most people kept the Z6 for other reasons, and they went back to the D850. But it was not only them who went back to the D850. Repeated concerns with quality control of Fujifilm GF lenses. And when this guy posted this article, a ton of users appeared out of the woods. Everybody with his own bad experience, and they went back to the D850. They had come from the D850, many of them, and they went back. And it was not only them. Lloyd Chambers reported unacceptable quality control in the lenses that he was receiving. One was actually so bad it was embarrassing. And at some point he says, indeed, I would say that most Fujifilm GF lenses I've used have had symmetry problems. And this is not something that the user will detect immediately. He has to fall under specific circumstances unless he tests the lens first. And this guy responded that everybody's pretty much doing it. He says, Nikon is not as bad, but not perfect either. And he says, I know these issues with Zeiss and Canon are very rare. Yeah, right. I returned two copies of the Milvus 35 1.4 because they had severe problems. Severe. I mean, not pixel peeping, severe. Before I get a third, that was good one. And my Distagon 28 is slightly asymmetric. Well, I can live with that. Most lenses are slightly asymmetric. If you ever find the perfect copy of a lens, never sell it. It must be an accident at the factory. The only two lenses that were perfect from the get-go were the Otus 55 and the Zoner 135 and the Milvus 135. This is my Distagon 28, which does have an asymmetry problem, which at wide apertures, such as in this case, shows a lot more. So look at the left side, sharp here, and it blurs in the middle. That's normal for this lens. It's the field curvature, all right? But look at the log all of a sudden. It gets blurry, right? Now look on the other side. A lot smaller blurry area, and the log is sharp. And at a distance, compare these trees over here with those trees over here. But I kept the lens because it is weird to begin with, so that just adds to the weirdness of it. I just have to accept that my field curvature is something like this. Now, don't start getting rid of good lenses because of a slight asymmetry problem. 90% of lenses have a slight asymmetry problem. Or it may be the sensor on your camera being a little askew. This happens too. So if you start photographing pages on your wall at maximum aperture and you find a tiny little bit difference from the left to the right, that's not a reason to ditch a good lens, because the next copy may be even worse. The only lenses that are supposed to be perfect upon delivery are the Otuses, and you pay thousands of dollars in quality control for that. So let's now talk about D850 accessories that I actually kept because they're functional, because I use them. Number one, the WRR10 remote flash controller, and it's remote. And it actually made me ditch the Godox AD200. I have made a detailed video on how to control from the camera multiple groups of flashes using the WRR10. The WRR10 does not need any batteries. It attaches to the front of the camera and it's powered by the camera battery. All the controls, you see them in the camera screen, which means you can lift the camera and fold down the screen and look at it, anything. So at the end, the only things that you are carrying in the field is the camera and the flash. That's it. You don't need anything else. The flash takes AA batteries from the gas station, if you want. So this is how it connects to the front of the camera. It also comes with a remote, that thing, that has a function button and a shutter button. I do not know what the function button does, because I've only used the shutter button. I know that it works from this distance, because that was a test shot for the remote. And I actually used the flash to give a little more light on the front leaves. I zoomed in the head of the flash to 135, and since that was the only good picture that day, I decided to crop and frame and blah blah blah. So why did I sell the Godox AD200? I had bought two of them. I mean the Adorama variation, which is flashpoint, and also the remote. So one would say now right away, wait a minute, this doesn't flip? Correct, it does not flip. Which means you set it on the hot shoe of the camera, and you can only see what you're doing when you hold the camera to your stomach. If you raise the camera a little bit, you cannot see what you're doing anymore. While with the other solution, I just flip the camera screen and I see exactly what I'm doing. So what I carry in the field, in the first option, is the Godox flash with its proprietary battery, which you have to keep in good condition because they ain't cheap, which is big also, needs space in the bag. The Godox transmitter, which does not flip and also needs space in the bag and needs its own battery too, and the camera. And the second option is to just use the WRR10, which is already connected on the camera and needs no battery, and the SP5000 in my coat pocket. And in the summer, when I don't have a coat pocket, yeah, I'll put it on the side pocket of the bag. And did I mention, what do you do if you just want to connect the flash to the hot shoe of the camera? What do you do with this? Because sometimes I don't even need to have the WRR10 for remote flash. I just connect the flash on the hot shoe. It has a rotating head and everything to point it any way you like, and it's got a zoom head, which means you choose if you want to zoom the head of the flash to point in specific areas or wider areas. It zooms all the way to 200 millimeters, the flash head. What am I going to do if I only had the Godox AD200 or something? So the Nikon solution is 10 times more flexible, right? So what's the advantage of the Godox? Well, it's 1.5 stops stronger in power. And in my experience, I have not found instances yet where I need all this power. The first images that follow are against the sun, talking about overpowering the sun. The kid is at school this week, so we're going to go through some old examples. 400th of a second, 1.8 ISO 64, and unfortunately I did not zoom the flash head, which I should have done. So the flash went into 28 millimeters, just like the lens, and it lit up the entire area. Look at this. Look at this waste of the flash power. What do we have here? 1,000th of a second, f1.4, ISO 64. 1,000th of a second. This flash synchronizes maximum power at 250. So at 1,000, it has already lost a lot of power. 640th of a second, 1.4, ISO 64, and at this point it's so obvious that I'm just taking test shots. 2,000th of a second, aperture 1.4. Why the hell would you need 2,000th of a second? Well, let's say birds are flying by. You see, that's what I'm saying. You generally do not need more than 125 of a second or 250. 1/60th of a second, and in this case we have the same exact flash output that we would have at 250, same output. But I chose 160 because I wanted the background not to be dark. F16, ISO 500. So why did I shoot an F16 here? Well, because I wanted the sun to have these rays, you see. Now this one is not against the sun. This is just filling in shadows. 250th of a second, 1.8, ISO 64. I shouldn't have used 1.8 because I wanted this shit to be a little more visible. Should have used 2.8. Ah, there you go, F2.2. 200th of a second, ISO 64. And now examples from the internet, whether you can shoot that with a speed light or not. You can shoot that with a cheap speed light. This is not against the sun, you're just filling in shadows. Oh, the original looks like that. Yeah, that's why you use some sort of a flash. You don't need an expensive one, cheap one, cheap speed light. Same here. Can you pull that off with a speed light? Absolutely. This is gonna be difficult if you want them as well to show well lit, because you're at a bigger distance over here and the speed light cannot fire all its power that far away. And I suspect this is also at a high shutter speed, and you're shooting against the sun and you want this, you need a little more power than that probably. Although this is a wide angle lens, this guy must actually be a lot closer than we see. This can be shot with a speed light unless she starts moving a lot further away. Speed light, and quite easy as a matter of fact. So these are all speed lights. What would be somewhere, and this is speed light too, I mean you can shoot it with a speed light easily, cheap speed light, and this one too. What is one case where you're actually going to need a powerful strobe? If this guy was running faster, because if you're going to use, let's say, 1,000th of a second at base ISO, ISO 64, don't cheat on the ISO, then you probably need a little more power on this one. Maybe something like this, like 2,000th of a second and base ISO, 100 ISO, maybe you need something a little more powerful. Or if you're using very thick modifiers and stuff, although I've shown you pictures with modifiers and they're just fine, yeah. Like this one, for example, 640th of a second, 1.8, I should have used 2.8 here, ISO 64. Here, 1,000th of a second, 1.8, ISO 64, at 35 millimeters, but that's a little too much flash. And here it is obvious that I zoomed in the head of the flash, and if I remember well, I zoomed in at 85 or something like that, because I have way too much light on here at 1,000th of a second. Remember that. That's 1,000th of a second. And this is 1,600th of a second. A little less light here, right, on the face. But you see how much easier it is to use the flash and light a subject really well with a speed light, even at high speeds, where the speed light here has lost 3/5 or 4/5 of its power. And the reason is that I'm not shooting against the sun. Because the problem is when the sun is behind the model, when it's against the camera. Here I'm just filling in shadows. Now, some people who use kind of thick modifiers, soft boxes and stuff, big modifiers, where you have to light the entire soft box, they might need a strobe here, although there is also another solution for the hobbyists, and that will be to buy two speed lights. Because this way you're going to have a lot more power, they're going to fire at the same time, but you also have flexibility all of a sudden. You can put them in different positions. So now you're going to say, well, why do all these professional photographers tell me that to take pictures outdoors, I need a powerful strobe? You just saw my RAW files. There's not better proof than that. And these are the same people who told you that you need a 24 megapixel camera to print 5x7s. So, number two, the really right stuff base plate for the D850. Specifically, this little tab over here goes to a hole in the bottom of the camera and provides a second point and prevents the camera from tilting when you put on a heavy lens. Because the ones that do not have this, sometimes you put a heavy lens and the camera on the side, I mean in portrait mode, and it starts going down. I mean, it starts tilting. It doesn't fall, it just tilts. This one prevents it. Also, remember this hole over here. I'm going to mention it later. Remember this, that it has on the side. And it comes with its own key that you actually have here at all times. It doesn't fall, it just slides in and out. Number three, Peak Design Clutch CL2. How many wrist straps and all that crap I've bought over the years?
More than 15.
Including the Nikon. This one is the best. So what is the biggest problem with straps? You cannot take your hand and put it in quickly. There you go. Remember the hole I said in the bottom? There it is. Just push it in so that it fits perfectly and you can tighten it from here. And there you go. And there you go. And there you go. Works with all Nikon DSLRs. Unfortunately, it's not too good on mirrorless. And this one, Really Right Stuff B2 ALA LLR2 lever release clamp. This is expensive because it's big. And why should it be big? Stability of this thing is out of this world, and you just do this. Now, you would also think that I still have the BH55 that I bought in April 2018. I sold it, and at the time, with the money that I got from the sale, I bought two of those with that money. I gave one to my daughter and one I kept on my monopod. I only changed the top head with the release lever clamp because it's more convenient. The knobs feel better than the BH55. It feels that I have better control with it. It's lighter and it feels it has the exact same stability. But where did I find this? How did I even know it exists? Have you ever seen a website testing tripods in such detail with instruments? This guy is serious. This is the best site for tripod and tripod head reviews in the world. And it's got tripod reviews, rankings, head reviews, rankings, technique, everything you want. It's called the Center Column. Amazing site. So now let's go to some stuff that I have been troubled with how they are sold lately. I have this monopod. It's very good. It is easy to carry, flips out really quickly, it is durable, it is steady. Nice. But I remember buying it for less than $80 without any discounts. I don't know what's going on at Manfrotto, but now it says it is 134. And I'm like, why? It's just a freaking monopod. Another case, which is actually a little scandalous if you think about it. Back in 2020, I bought the Manfrotto Gearhead, the 405, Golden State Art 5x7 albums, and I'm very happy with them. I strongly recommend them. And a couple of other things, and my total bill was $461. The Gearhead itself was $320. And now it's $609. It's the same head. It was $320. I would not have recommended it at $320. I thought it was too expensive. And now it's $609. What the hell happened? Is it made out of gold now? It is less flexible than any other head. It is just precision for landscapes and architecture. And it's heavy as shit. You cannot put this on a light tripod because you cannot carry the thing anymore. It's going to be flipping on one side all the time. That's how heavy this thing is. And this thing here was like $28 or $30. What the hell happened? And it's $42 now, and it says discount from $60. And you know, it's a cute table tripod that expands, actually. Does it hold the D850? Well, with a light lens. With a light lens, yeah, it does. Don't put any 7200 on it. Or it's good for your iPhone, mostly, shit like that. So now you're going to say, why the hell are you talking about lens pouches? Because this one has a really wide opening. And many of you, like me, cannot fit your lenses with the hood reversed on the lens. You cannot fit it in ordinary pouches because the opening is not wide enough. This one, this specific one, has a really wide opening on the top. You can fit a really fat lens with its hood reversed as well. And finally, this thing over here, the GPS, this specific one, it's called DGPS, and it attaches on the front of the camera. It stays out of sight, out of mind. Most of the times I forget I have it there. The thing is that it consumes almost no power at all, like nothing. I have left the camera turned on in storage, and they both go to sleep, both the camera and this thing. Out in the field, it powers up quickly, but you have to make sure that the camera has not gone to sleep, as a matter of fact. So half press the shutter so that it wakes up, and within, I don't know, 15 seconds, it's up and running. And the thing is that it works inside buildings as well, which, as a viewer correctly noted, means that it takes the coordinates from cell towers. But I also noticed in one location in Michigan that although my daughter did not have any cell reception, this thing still worked and it showed coordinates on the camera screen and it writes them on the exe file. So this is a very good GPS. It works to this day. And that's it. These are the accessories that I am actually using, and I have found them to be of great value, and I have enjoyed them a lot. And some of them were the result of buying the one, buying the other one, and throwing them all and buying this one as the last one, as the good one, that actually works, and it shows that it actually has some value, and it's well designed and well made. So somebody comes and says, why don't you just ditch the big camera and get yourself a small camera that you can carry with you at all time and do street photography. And you know where the conversation is going. He wants to sell you a Leica so that you can walk around with $15,000 camera and lens around your neck in the streets of Chicago and San Francisco. Because these people were taking pictures and that was their job all day long. That's what they were doing in post-war European cities. I grew up in Europe. I know how these situations evolve, and people are talking to each other and blah blah, and they're always gathered together, and nothing is settled. Everything is uneasy. Nothing is settled. So in American series, everything is pretty much settled. Nothing is happening unless you stage it. And if something happens, it's most likely something sad or dangerous. And that is also an explanation why we had so many pictures all of a sudden during some period of homeless people in America as street photography, because everything else was ordinary, settled. So the only thing that was not ordinary were, let's say, homeless people. So you need a Leica for this? Like a Sumilux 50? No, you don't. Now I live in the suburbs and nothing happens in the suburbs. So I wanted to go to Lake County, 45 minutes north, to buy cheap cigarettes. And I took my flip phone with me at the time. And I said, if I see something, I'm going to go from the old roads, not the highway. So if I see something interesting, I'll take a snapshot and then I'll come back with my big camera and take a nice picture. And that's how I found this building. I passed through it on the daytime. I took a snapshot with it. But there were cars parked in the lot and people around, and it was a mess. And a lot of traffic. You couldn't stop anywhere. That's why I came the following night to take the picture, and almost in the middle of the night. If I had taken this in the daytime, even with a Leica, with bad light and all the cars parked and people and this and that, it would have been a terrible picture. Living in the suburbs and with everything being far away, you plan things. You go somewhere to take pictures with a purpose, and you use your car, which means the size of the camera is irrelevant. And if I wanted street photography casually in Chicago or someplace else, here's my camera. $65, it says. And it's got a zoom lens and a flash and a big screen, easy buttons, and powered by AA batteries. And it's 16 megapixels. The best copies that we have of the street photographs of the masters about 80 years ago, the equivalent of them is about 3 or 4 megapixels. That's it. They're not better than that. They're not better than 5 megapixels in today's terms. That's 16. $65. Or I can just use a modern iPhone. They're more than capable, except in low light. In low light, I can carry something like the Z50. My daughter took this picture with a Z50 from the car in Nashville while my ex-wife was driving. Those are the specs. That's the RAW file. You can raise the shadows. Now, professionals are different, of course, because if you're like this guy who shoots journals, you know, photo essays and stuff, you are in a location and you carry the camera, I don't know, 5-6 hours or 10 hours even. And in this case, yeah, you need something light, obviously. Otherwise, it becomes an issue.
Breaking news. Sony announces that they are the number one camera manufacturer. But are they really?
No, they're not. The number one camera manufacturer in the world, by far, exceeding everybody else combined, is Apple. Because when you buy an iPhone, you buy the camera too. It's a camera. It's not just a software feature. It's an actual camera in there. Apple is the number one camera manufacturer in the world. And the reason an American company is again number one by far, like Kodak used to be in the past, is you press the button, we do the rest. Or you can do it yourself. People want simplicity. They don't want the most exquisite quality. They prefer simplicity. That's what Americans understand better than the Japanese. Thanks a lot. Bye.